This is an issue, gang. I'm so sorry. I couldn't find any tissues, so I apologise.
Would you like a clean handkerchief?
It's linen!
It is linen. I'm afraid to say constituents often cry in my surgeries, so I find it very useful to have clean handkerchiefs.
I can imagine that so clearly.
Welcome to Have I Got News For You. I'm Mel Gedroych, and in the news this week, on a well-deserved break in Tenerife, sports director Mike Ashley dives effortlessly into his swimming pool. At Chevening House, as Boris Johnson, Liam Fox and David Davis all bring their pets for the weekend, it's a tough day for the local dog walker. And at his constituency in Tatton, George Osborne denies he's still obsessed with austerity as he makes a few adjustments to the village Christmas tree. On Ian's team tonight is a Conservative MP who in 2007 married Helena de Cher, who I believe was one of a set of six. Please welcome Jacob Rees-Mogg MP. With Paul tonight is creator and star of Citizen Khan, the funniest thing to come out of Birmingham since the estimated completion date of HS2. Please welcome Adil Ray. And we start with the biggest stories of the week. Mm. Paul and Adil, take a look at this.
It's Theresa May. That's the House of Commons a long time ago.
The England cricket team. Oh, yeah.
There we are. And they're setting fire to the EU fire regulations. there she is again.
There was a judge asleep there.
There was a sleeping judge.
That's
there.
An appalling slur right at the top of the show.
Yeah.
Suggestion it was so dull in court he'd be asleep. Do you think that's appalling?
Indeed, I'm shocked.
Good.
The wigs are very hot though, so maybe he was having a quick.
Are they usually wide awake, the judges you appear in front of?
In the Supreme Court, they don't wear wigs. They're rather modern in the Supreme Court.
Oh,
they just wear ordinary clothes.
They come as the Supremes.
This is the news that Parliament backed Theresa May to trigger the Brexit process by the end of March next year. The papers seemed pretty clear. The Telegraph had MP's hand blank cheque for Brexit. The I had victory for PM, Commons backs May on Brexit. The Express went with hooray, MPs say yes to EU exit. While the headlines on the 10 o'clock news on the British Bremoaning Corporation on Wednesday didn't even mention it. So, who was this a victory for, Labour or the government? What do we think?
A huge victory for the government. Triumph for the Conservative Party, for Mrs May and the Chief Whip.
This is the post-truth era. It was a bit of a climb down there, wasn't it? To say, I'm not going to tell you the plan, and then say, well, we will tell you the plan.
We've been told the plan. We're leaving the European Union. Brexit means Brexit. And from
yes, of course.
No, that's the aim. What's the plan?
No. That's what happens. That's what happens at the end of a two-year process. That is it. We leave. And it's been very clear from the other side, from Mr Tusk and from Mr Barnier, that we can't cherry-pick, that there is no such thing as hard Brexit or soft Brexit. There's either Brexit or remaining in the European Union.
But Mrs May used this metaphor of a cliff edge. And that was your leader. That was her own metaphor. We don't want to go over the cliff edge.
She used a better metaphor. So we would have a red, white and blue Brexit, which is the one I prefer.
Right. So you're cherry-picking her metaphor.
I am, yes.
Let's have a little look.
Is it hard, soft? Is it grey, white? Actually, we want a red, white and blue Brexit. That is the right Brexit for the United Kingdom.
Hang on a minute. No mention of brown in there. I know what she's up to.
Yeah. It's a wonderful patriotic way of putting it. We all understand exactly what she means. She's going to go into these negotiations like Boadicea on her chariot and is going to come back with a fine success to the United Kingdom.
What, with the knives going there?
How did the Star make this story more fun while not exactly making it any clearer?
Theresa May with her kit off.
Almost.
Oh.
Yes,
almost her kit off.
Have a little look at this. We go up the body, Jerry, Theresa. Wow.
I didn't see anything like that in the Financial Times, but then they're terrible. They're terrible Remainers.
Well, people who know what they're talking about in the financial markets.
But, Jacob, am I right in saying that you wanted a hard white Brexit with a runny yolk?
You're absolutely right, yes.
Is that right?
But you're absolutely spot on. I think that's how we should have it. We should have an absolutely solid and clear Brexit, but we should be generous to our European friends as far as we possibly can be.
When you knock the top off your egg of a morning, Jacob, are you a peeler or are you a slicer?
Do you know that I'm all in favour of Brexit? I never have breakfast, so I can't really...
Breakfast?
Oh, or breakfast.
His butler does it. Come on. Yeah, so you're asking the wrong person, really.
Perhaps he doesn't walk around in daylight.
It's all right, we'll carry on. Good. Excellent.
I love this. It's brisk.
Yes, bloody brisk.
Have you got somewhere to go?
I do, actually.
Channel 4. Yes.
Now, the Daily Mail insisted that it was right to discuss the 11 Supreme Court judges' backgrounds, and why not? Mm. Given that they will be passing judgment on what will be an issue that affects the lives of everyone in the country, here they are. Here are the 11 judges. That looks like a picture of your stag party, Jacob. 9 went to Oxbridge, 9 went to public school, 2 of which are Old Etonians, and there is one woman.
What, only 2 Old Etonians?
I'm afraid so, Jacob.
Most of them are in prison these days.
What's the official title of the government's lead QC, James Edie? Do you know?
Jimmy.
Jimmy Edie.
How are you doing, Jimmy? All right, are you?
Not too bad, you know. Now I've become top lawyer and all that.
Is it Treasury Council or some type?
Treasury is correct, but he's got another little...
Treasury tag?
No. Treasury...
Chest. Treasury deer.
Oh, devil.
No.
Treasury devil.
The Treasury devil.
The Treasury devil.
It's absolutely right. Well done, Jacob. Now, who is everyone's favourite judge? Who's proving, really, to be the kind of star of the Supreme Court, certainly on social media?
Judge Rinder.
There's another one, though.
Is there?
John Consumption.
Should I... Yes! Should we have a look at him? He's got very lovely hair. And, yes, he's got a big brain. Look at that forehead.
A huge brain. He's written the authoritative history of the Hundred Years' War at the same time as being a very leading legal figure. He is a most extraordinarily clever man.
How does he keep his hair going up like that?
Well,
that's amazing.
He's got a hair dryer hanging off his trousers. That's what he tells the wife, anyway.
This court case, of course, is pretty momentous. It's all been extremely exciting. Shall we have a look at the riveting workings of the Supreme Court?
Yeah.
Well, sadly, we're not actually allowed to show you any footage from the court, but do you think it'd be possible to sort of stage our own repertory theatre court?
Absolutely. I'd fight anybody who said we couldn't do it.
All right, good. Right, I've got some scripts here. Paul, I'd very much like you to be Lord Panic. And Adol, please, will you take the part of Lord Clark? Jacob, I'd like you to be Lady Hale. Please. And Ian, please, the President. No expense spared here on Have I Got News For You. We've got wigs. We've got ruddy wigs. I know, Jacob, you said they don't have wigs in the Supreme Court.
They don't, no.
But tonight they do. Just go with it, Jacob. So 2 comedy judge wigs for you. Now, of course, we need a...
Which way do you want? Which way do I go on? I'm afraid I'm not wearing a wig.
Come on!
I'll wear it.
Wig, 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 wig,
Wait. I'm not wearing a wig for the very obvious reason I'm a Tory. When I can't wear a wig. Ah. I'll happily put it on the desk in front of me.
All right, my love. No, that's good. Well done, Adel. You see, Adel's wearing a wig.
I'm wearing a wig.
They accuse people like me of not integrating.
I've reached the top.
Stop! In the name of love.
I very much like the way one flap is sort of back and one is forward.
It's deliberate.
It's very alluring.
It's flirting.
Ian, we've got the president for you.
Who is the president?
Sorry. I said, could we get a president wig? I think
it's Trump, isn't it?
They might. There's been a bit of a mix-up at the wig store. Sorry, Ian. Catch. Jacob Duke. Just because Jacob's not wearing a wig, Ian's not going to wear one either. Well, I don't know about that.
I think we've won this round already.
Yeah. It's amazing the number of people who think they've got dignity to lose. Isn't it?
Right.
Get ready when you are.
Now, it's about the pronunciation of the name in an old case. OK, lovely. So, gents, let the drama begin, my darlings.
I'll kick off, shall I? Can I come on to the fifth topic, which is De Keyser and the other case law?
Have I been mispronouncing that case all my adult life?
Would your ladyship like to tell me the correct...
De Keyser.
I will call it De Keyser.
I may be wrong. I am often wrong.
You say De Keyser, I say De Keyser.
Down here, we think it is De Keyser.
Very strong.
We can each stick to our own because the transcript will not give away what we have called it.
Oh, ladies and gentlemen, round of applause.
I tell you what, if we keep these on, they'll have to use it.
They won't be able to cut it out.
We've got them on now.
You should have thought of that. Put your hand down, props.
Hey, look at this. We're having a party.
The Supreme Court panel includes Baroness Hale and 10 lords, for whom this is a particularly busy time of year, as they have a lot of a-leaping to do. One of the Supreme Court judges is Lord Clark of Stone-cum-Ebony. Which I can only assume is some sort of public school version of rock, paper, scissors.
I think you were right not to wear the wigs.
I think you're right.
Jacob, what did you whisper just then? Something about the wigs?
I said I thought the two of us were right not to wear the wigs.
They're still here if you change your mind.
Well, you know, it wouldn't be beyond the wit of the production team just to sort of have a photograph of you and just sort of, you know, computer Photoshop the wig on top.
But the BBC wouldn't behave in such a disgraceful way.
No. Well, I've given them half an hour's warning.
Ian and Jacob, take a look at this.
This is a by-election. It's being held today. I don't think he's won. That's the Lib Dems. That's a fish. He's not a Lib Dem. And that's Zach. Something fishy here, says the fish.
I thought I had a bad day.
At by-elections, we had one last week where, very sadly, Zach Goldsmith lost his seat, and we've got one in Sleaford North Highcombe today. We will have the result by the time this is being watched, and I expect it will be a gigantic victory for Conservatism, and therefore a day of rejoicing and song.
It was a big Tory majority that was overturned, though, wasn't it?
Yeah.
We didn't have a candidate in Richmond. Zach was standing as an independent.
Why didn't the Tories have a Tory candidate?
Why didn't the Tories have a Tory candidate?
That's what I asked.
but because we thought it might reduce Zach's chances of winning.
But why did you want him to win? He just said, I resign.
Because he had been a Conservative before, and to be perfectly honest, we didn't want the Lib Dems to win, which was a worse result than an independent winning. And sadly, that worse result came to pass.
But sort of in spades, really.
Well, not really. They've gone from 8 to 9 in the House of Commons, which I don't think is going to change the world much.
Zach lost for the second time in a year.
Man.
It's not a good year for him,
was it? He's had a heck of a year. Of course, he lost the London mayoral election to Sadiq Khan after a campaign that involved a little bit of scaremongering about Muslims. And who else became embroiled in this issue this week?
Oh, yes, the
American author who said that London is becoming Islamic.
Yes.
Yes, yes.
Janie Johnson is her name, and she tweeted this. My friends just returned from London, shocked, hadn't been in 20 years, said London is gone, all Islamic. Now, Janie's tweet was met with a variety of responses. I can confirm one of the London landmarks is actually a giant woman.
Yeah. That is now known as the Birkin.
The Birkin.
Yeah.
Yes, somebody else responded to Janie. Cricklewood held out till 2014, but the resistance fell and it was awful. My uncle had his hand chopped off for eating frazzles. The Labour candidate in Richmond lost his deposit. Do you know any of the issues that he is big on?
Well, one of them was not getting anyone to vote for him. That became quite a big issue.
There are more members of the Labour Party in Richmond than people who voted for him, which is quite poor if you can't even get your own members to vote for him.
According to The Telegraph, Labour's candidate in Richmond by-election wants to ban loo roll and doesn't use it at home.
Probably needed toilet paper when he saw his results.
Yes. Does he champion the B-Day?
Oh, I don't like a B-Day.
Don't you?
I don't know. I
2 days before D-Day, did you know that?
I don't know. Jacob, how do you feel about a B-Day? It's not... Is it non-new? Is it a bit non-new?
Very continental.
What do you think Zach might do with all this free time that he's suddenly got?
Well, I hope he'll come back into politics.
He looks a bit broken, though, Jacob.
Oh, he's made of tough stuff. No, yeah. he's got a... Like his father, he'll bounce back.
Oh, it's going to be really hard for him, though, isn't it? To go back to that millions and go back to his big house. I mean, it's going to be really tough for him. How will he survive?
Yes. Or your predecessor, more accurately.
Yeah, his father wanted Private Eye to be shut down.
Tried a criminal libel action.
He did. You've got a very good memory for these things. Yeah. I don't take it personally. I just hope he, never seen again.
Zach May wants to follow in the footsteps of highly respected former leading lights of their parties, Ed Balls and Michael Portillo. Have a little look at this.
These words were first sung by Chancellor Norman Lamont after he screwed the economy. There they go. Happy, happy people. Happy, smiling people. Just hope they know the way out. Yes, there they go.
Did they actually hear the music?
I don't know.
What was Michael Portillo doing?
He looked like a sort of weird donkey, didn't he? Yeah. His legs were all over the shop. Who did we learn is quite thin-skinned this week?
Boris Johnson?
Yeah. Ministers have been ordered to stop making jokes about him in a bid to banish his cabinet clown reputation. Do you think people might take Mr. Johnson more seriously if he actually learnt to dress himself properly? Have a look at this.
I think that is exactly the attire you would expect a dashing young foreign secretary to have.
Give us an approximation of where your tie goes down to tonight. Is it a little short job or is it a low slung? Because we don't know.
Tie
we don't...
goes to a suitable level for a tie to go.
Are we still talking about ties?
We're talking about ties. But that is ludicrous.
I think it's perfectly reasonable to have a long tie.
It's more of a noose, really, isn't it?
Now, Jacob, you supported Boris for the leadership,
yes,
didn't you?
Yes, great man.
Until he was...
I'm very popular on Have I Got News For You.
You supported Boris until he was stabbed in the back by Michael Gove. Then you supported Gove until he was knocked out. And then you supported Andrea Leadsom. Presumably that was kind of just for a laugh. And in any case, are you really a fan of Mrs. May and the Chief Whips?
Oh, absolutely. There is greater zeal in a convert than there is in somebody who starts off down the road, though I sadly accept that my predictions during the Conservative leadership campaign were not always correct.
You see, you can do the diplomacy thing, whereas Boris really can't do it, can he?
Yes.
Oh, I don't know. I think he's marvellous. I'm a jolly good fellow.
But you're just being silly now.
No, I'm not. No, I'm not. I think he's a great representative for the country on the world stage. People want to meet Boris. They're interested in him.
They want to be offended by him.
The row today is that he said something that most people know to be true. So I can't see why people should be too upset. I think the
but
shock...
But then Mrs May said it wasn't true.
No, Mrs May said it didn't fully represent government policy. That's a different thing.
This is the Sleaford and North Highcombe by-election that's happening as we speak. As has become tradition, the by-election featured three joke candidates who stood for the Monster Raving Loony Party, the Bus Pass Elvis Party and the Labour Party. According to The Times, the Green Party were offered £250,000 to sit out the Richmond by-election, but the offer was rejected after it failed the Green Party's ethical tests as it was going to be paid in meat-based fivers. According to a recent review of social integration, newcomers to this country could soon be made to swear an oath that encourages immigrants to embrace British values, which these days presumably goes, I do solemnly swear to shout at myself on buses and tell myself to piss off back where I came from. And onwards to round two. Oh, I love this one, the picture spin quiz. Okay, fingers on buzzers, teams.
Yeah. That's Mark Carney.
Yeah.
Yes.
The governor of the Bank of England, who says we shouldn't worry about anything we're worrying about at the moment because all our jobs are going to be taken over by robots.
You are bang on.
All these robots coming over here taking our jobs. Jobs meant for us Pakistanis.
I do remember Harold Macmillan saying exactly the same thing.
What, jobs for us Pakistanis?
Yeah.
I knew it!
Andy Haldane, the bank's chief economist, did have some slightly reassuring news. What jobs did he deem safe from the robo-invasion?
Robot-making jobs.
They're going to do
good.
Well. They're
going to
do really
good.
Well.
Undertakers.
Oh, kind of...
You don't want to be buried by a robot,
close.
Do you? You will be sadly missed.
Hairdressers.
Yes, hairdressers. Ian.
Oh, you're kidding.
Hairdressers, carers and nannies, apparently.
What? Absolutely.
Well, nannies are indestructible.
Why might robots not be an immediate threat if you work in a laundry?
They're allergic to steam. Rust them up.
Good, we should all get into water-based industries.
Yeah. I have a superior intelligence, but it's steam. I cannot take this steam.
You're really enjoying that character, Paul, aren't you?
You're really good at robots.
Very
well,
good.
There's a reason for
Come
that.
Come on, then.
Brexit exterminate.
Jacob, come on, robot.
We've all
come
done
on,
them.
Come on.
Come on, Jacob.
Come on.
I would if I could, but I
That
can't.
Was brilliant!
now, according to BBC News,
yes.
Panasonic have invested $60 million and 10 years in developing the Laundroid. Yeah. It's the size of a wardrobe and can fold a shirt in 10 minutes. It's a long time.
10 minutes?
I know.
Yeah.
The NHS has already started using robots. A robot is replacing the NHS's only registered rectal teaching assistant. The NHS used to employ one man, to offer up his rectum to teach students how to carry out examinations. He is being replaced by a robotic rectum. And here it is.
What's that?
I know.
What is that bit between his legs?
We're all thinking that, aren't we? What is that? Is it the end of Boris Johnson's tie?
That patient's beyond having his rectum examined. Look at him, he's got no legs, no torso. What's up his arse is the least of his troubles.
Does it make the noise?
Yeah.
Ah! Or,
Oh, you're going to take me out for dinner now.
Now, which politician have some people suggested might actually be a robot?
Dr. Liam Fox.
No.
No? But he's got wires coming out the back of his head.
Hillary Clinton. Mainly because she claps like this.
It's all context. If that was a pair of cymbals, she'd be doing really well in the 1812 overture.
Yes, although Michael Gove has also been under some suspicion, at least from Laura Swift on Twitter, since she noticed his human suit malfunctioning. Yes, this is Mark Carney's warning that 15 million jobs may be at risk from robots. Just Eat has delivered its first takeaway using a delivery droid. The customer was delighted with the service until he failed to tip and the droid vaporised his house with a thermo laser. Meanwhile, a robot has gone berserk, injuring bystanders at a Chinese tech fair. Here is the robot. It looks like someone's thrown one of Little Mix into a flip-top bin. Fingers on buzzers, please.
Yeah, absolutely.
There we go.
Person of the Year.
Oh, yes, Time magazine, you're right, yeah.
As if the year hadn't been bad enough. And it's very prestigious. There are a huge number of people up for the award. For
Nigel Farage was one of them.
Farage was up. There are small mercies.
Do you know who else was in the running?
No, anyone. What? Death, famine, war, plague.
Vladimir Putin.
Putin was up.
Yeah, Putin was up for it. Nigel Farage. And Beyonce. What has Trump previously said about Time magazine in a tweet?
Oh, tell us.
Well, in 2013, he tweeted, "The Time magazine list of the 100 most influential people is a joke and a stunt of a magazine that will, like Newsweek, soon be dead. Bad list." And even last year, Trump tweeted in response to Angela Merkel winning, "I told you at Time magazine would never pick me as person of the year despite being the big favourite. They picked the person who's ruining Germany." Now, to be fair, Time has not exactly been very consistent with Trump either. How have they previously covered him? Do you know?
Honestly.
They've been rather put off by some of his antics.
They have indeed. Here's their cover from August, meltdown. Here's their cover from October, total meltdown. And here is this week, Trump, man of the year. Now, what have people been noticing about this image of Trump on the cover of Time? Do you notice anything there?
Oh, do you think it's a subtle devil joke?
Exactamundo. They think the M has been giving Donald horns. There we go. And how did Time explain that?
Incredible accident. We don't really pay a lot of attention to what's on the cover. The person taking the photograph wasn't the person designing the background. They should have met, but they didn't really, and we thought we'd get away with it.
Well, Time said it was a common occurrence. Everyone from Margaret Thatcher to Pope Francis to Jesus to Darth Vader has received the rough end of Time's horns. Donald Trump's a controversial choice, but being chosen as Time's Person of the Year isn't necessarily an endorsement. After all, the award has previously gone to some of the most notorious figures in history, including Hitler, Stalin and Bono. Donald Trump has risked offending China with a series of late-night tweets. Tensions between the president-elect and China could lead to a diplomatic incident. If Trump ever visits Beijing, there are fears that the Chinese might grab the bird's nest off his head and turn it into soup. Fingers very much on buzzers, please, teams.
This is about the Turner Prize, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Spot on.
Yes.
It's the news that a massive arse has just missed out on winning the Turner Prize. So what did win?
Well, a sort of collection of bits all stuck together.
Yes. It's basically a load of old rubbish. Same as every year, sure. But this year, it was on purpose. Macclesfield-born artist Helen Martin carefully arranges objects from everyday life, including cotton buds, marbles, snooker chalk and bicycle chains, to create sculptural poems like this. Does that speak to you, Jacob? Do you like that?
It doesn't speak to me.
It's a bit Blue Peter, isn't it?
But I think you need the one that was made earlier.
Oh.
She loved that over there. Really supported you.
Mrs. Rees-Mogg, welcome.
Now, Michael Gove certainly was not impressed. What did he tweet?
He thinks it's all rubbish and ugly and gloomy and so on and so forth.
He said in his tweet, hashtag Turner Prize 2016, congratulations to Helen Martin, but hashtag honestly, is this equal to Turner, Ruskin, even Holman Hunt? Of course not, hashtag modish crap. Hard to pull off, I think, cultural snobbery when you're tweeting like a total hashtag aunt. Now, Gove also thought that the prize was a celebration, albeit a celebration of ugliness, nihilism and narcissism, the tragic emptiness of now. Come on, Mike, things are going to pick up. shall we have a little look at some of the other entries? I'll show you one of their works and you have to guess what it's about. What is going on here?
Is it the entrance to the new gift shop?
Now, what's this one about? Have a look at this one.
Never have a suit made by a bricklayer.
It's not a suit I would choose.
It's another work, actually, from Anthea Hamilton's show. Lichen, libido, chastity. Sounds a bit like Jamie Oliver calling his kids in for dinner. It wouldn't be the Turner Prize, of course, without the Turnip Prize, which featured terrible punning works of art. For example, 2013's winner was this, a play on words. So, teams, buzz in if you can guess what this year's entrants for the Turnip Prize are called. What do we think?
Brexit.
Very strong, Ian, absolutely. That's bricks, spelling out the word it to make Brexit. Well done.
Anyway, I would think I'd worked as a terrible journalist.
Have a look at this one. This is a Barbie doll giving birth to a party blower to make... Sorry. It's Boris Johnson's tie, yet again. She's in...
Labour.
Yeah.
Labour blows something.
No.
Labour Party.
Labour Party. Well done. I think you both get that. It's very good. And finally, here is this year's winner of the Turnip Prize. This is a black pole... to make?
Oh, pole dart?
Yes! Yeah. Well done, Adel. Absolutely right.
I can't believe I'm so pleased with myself for getting that.
This is the announcement of the Turner Prize. One of the losing entries was a photographic portrait of IKEA kitchen countertops which had been left out in the sun. And that lost. Tough year. Time now for the odd one out round. Kim Jong-un, Zacchaeus, Mike Ashley and Lois Olsen.
We know the topical ones, Zacchaeus. He was a tax collector and was therefore shunned by a lot of people in those days who didn't want to pay taxes. How much things have changed. Is it not about tax?
Not to do with taxes, but it is to do with money.
Well, that's the man from Sports Direct.
Mm-hmm, Mike Ashley.
Who didn't pay people enough.
Yes. Well, they've all earned money, but she's won some money.
Oh, I think you haven't mentioned Kim. Kim Jong-un. It's more to do with
him. He's the only one in charge of a rogue nuclear state.
They all have too much money, apart from Kim Jong-un, who's had to start selling dog meat ready meals to raise money for some nuclear warheads. Absolutely true, apparently. So who is Kim planning on selling his dog meat ready meals to?
Dogs.
Is he hoping to export them?
Yes.
Is it the first of our new exciting trade deals?
Dog meat from North Korea.
According to the Sun newspaper, chubby despot Kim Jong-un reckons he can... reckons he can make a killing when he flogs the food abroad. Included in the range is powdered dog to which you just add hot water, presumably called not poodle. Predictably, this story did cause a stir in the comments section on the Sun Online. Well, actually, there was just one comment. Stephen Bentley wrote, "Fat boy Squarehead." Now, you mentioned the older lady in the foursome, 80-year-old Lois Olsen, that is, from Canada. She won $50 million in the lottery this week. Wow. How did she react to the incredible news, do you know?
Bloody hell!
She's from Canada.
All right. Bloody hell!
She's from Canada. Yeah. She says, I'm too old for this. I would have liked to have won this 20 or 30 years ago. Can anyone tell me some unusual things that would be more likely to happen to you than winning the UK's lottery?
Struck by lightning?
Mm-hmm.
Playing centre-forward for Burnley.
According to The Independent, you're more likely to be hit by part of a plane falling from the sky, die from flesh-eating bacteria, be crushed by a meteor, give birth to identical quadruplets, become an astronaut, win an Oscar, or die being left-handed and using a right-handed product. Now, why did Sports Direct's billionaire Mike Ashley have cause to regret having so much money earlier this year? What happened to him?
Oh, he took out a wad of £20 notes in front of his staff and it got a certain amount of comment about it.
Yeah, they were 50 quid notes,
£50 notes, were they not £20 notes?
Here he is. Look at this. There we go. In the Bible, Zacchaeus was described as a despised tax collector. Zacchaeus was particularly despised by the Roman stand-up comedian, Jimmius Carus. Oh, hang on, Jacob, sorry. Yeah, I've just got word in from the photoshopping department. Have a little look at this. Time now for the Missing Words round, which this week features as its guest publication, Carrot Country.
That's...
It's got a regular medical page entitled, What's Up, Doc? And we start with, what was purple, scrawny and pungent?
The three dwarves that didn't make it into the pantomime. Purple, scrawny and pungent. Hey, still right.
A carrot.
It is, of course, to do with carrots. The answer is the ancestor to the modern-day carrot. Oh. Carrot Country reveals that carrots used to be purple, red and black until orange carrots, as we know them, were bred by the Dutch. So selective breeding made them orange, just like the Trump family. Next, you'll be surprised at just how close you are to what?
I'm sticking with carrots.
Is it death?
Close.
Heaven.
Heaven? No.
Heaven. Devon. No.
Devon. Devon. The answer is a nuclear bomb.
Really?
Yeah. The Metro reports that the Russian RS-28 Sarmat missile is capable of destroying an area the size of France, which ideally would be France. Next, in 200 million years, there will be 25 what?
Carrots.
Jacob, are you just going to say carrots? Mm.
Yes.
Every single answer?
Well, I've got one right and we've got a point, so I might get another.
I know this one. It's 25 Liberal MPs. They're building slowly, but, you know, in 200 million years, they're going to be right back up there.
It's 25 hours in the day because the Earth is going slower. Yeah. And therefore, we're going to have an extra hour in the day.
You're absolutely right. Yeah. It'll be 25 hours in a day. Next, it's official. 2016 is the year what?
Of the carrot. You've got to...
It's got to be. It's got to be.
Absolutely, absolutely right. Carrot. It's the year of the carrot. Hang on. That's according to the vegetarian option of the Chinese horoscope. And next year is the year of the brassica, so do put that date in your colander.
Good. I like that.
Next, what is a major enemy of the carrot?
Nuclear war.
Snowman.
Weevil.
Oh, well done.
What?
Paul, absolutely right, yes. The answer is the carrot weevil is a...
I didn't even know I knew that.
It's brilliant. Next, carrots undercover what?
Carrots undercover posing as international playboys in French bars.
I may look like a carrot, but I am an international playboy.
Carrots undercover ISIS sleeping cells.
Carrots undercover grow bigger than those that are not undercover.
I have to give that to you. Yeah. The answer is carrots undercover keep growing well into winter.
Yeah.
This is the tip for the carrot growers to cover the earth with black plastic sheeting. Another way is to put extra soil and compost on them. Mmm, the plot thickens. And finally, Finally, dog what in Devon like it is totally normal?
Carrot.
Riding a horse.
Oh, very strong, Jacob. Absolutely right. A dog rides horse in Devon like it's totally normal. Here
have you
is...
got the picture? It's a very good picture.
We've absolutely got the picture. Of the dog riding the horse. Or as it's also known, the North Korean set menu for two. So the final scores are on 7, Paul and Adil, but on 10, Ian and Jacob.
Extraordinary win. Amazing. Fine. I've no idea.
On which note, we say thank you to our panellists, Ian Hislop and Jacob Rees-Mogg, Paul Merton and Adil Ray, and I leave you with news that, as Donald Trump continues to select his White House team, there's a successful application for the post of Oval Office intern. Campaigning in Lincolnshire, a confident Nick Clegg points the way to number 76. And after putting an extra large Christmas cake in the oven, disaster strikes for Paul Hollywood as he eagerly decides to lick the bowl. Good night. Jacob, do you mind if I have a blow?
No, 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 by all means, son.
No wonder you got 10 points.